Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy 4th of July. Whoever you are, wherever you are in your journey of faith, you're welcomed here. So we welcome all of you and those on Facebook Live. And today we're going to have the theme will be liberty and freedom. And so let us open our hearts to the one who offers us true freedom. Blessed be the one, holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
Dios omnipotente para quien todos los corazones están manifiestos. Todos los deseos conocidos y ningún secreto encubierto. Purifica los pensamientos de nuestros corazones con la inspiración de tu Santo Espíritu, para que perfectamente te amemos y dignamente celebremos tu Santo Nombre. Por Cristo nuestro Señor. Amén. Amén. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, in whose name the founders of this country won liberty for themselves and for us, and lit the torch of freedom for nations then unborn, grant that we and all the people of this land may have grace to maintain our liberties with righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. The Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who is not partial and takes no bribe, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. You shall fear the Lord your God. Him alone you shall worship. To him you shall hold fast. And by his name you shall swear. He is your praise. He is your God, who has done for you these great and awesome things that your own eyes have seen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will exalt you, O God, my King.
Praise your name forever and ever. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as his inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had the opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country. That is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So today we celebrate the 245th anniversary of the founding of our nation, a time on which the Declaration of Independence from Britain was signed by 56 courageous and self-sacrificing leaders. It reads, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that when any form of government becomes destructive to these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it and to institute new government." What exactly is liberty, and how does it differ from freedom? This is the subject of today's sermon. The terms freedom and liberty have often been used interchangeably, and that's caused a little bit of confusion because the definition of these terms are actually quite different. Liberty is predominantly an external construct. It is the state of being free in a society from oppressive restrictions imposed by an authority regarding one's way of life, behavior, or political views. Now, freedom, on the other hand, is an internal construct. It's really a state of mind. It is the ability to choose one's attitude in a variety of circumstances. Now, having been brought up in the city of Boston and educated there, liberty was a very important value for me. And I was taught that the Boston Tea Party was one of the most seminal events in the life of our nation. And certainly the words that the early patriots uttered rang in my mind, like, "I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death." Patrick Henry. Now, after the Revolutionary War and the ratification of the Constitution, the Founding Fathers extended essential rights and civil liberties by adding the Bill of Rights. And these amendments gave us more liberties than before, such as free speech, freedom to worship our own religion and God, the right to bear arms, trial by jury, the right to protest, and reserving rights to the people and the states. And I am forever grateful for these liberties and feel blessed to live in this country. The Bill of Rights seemed to be written in a language that excluded no one, but it was not intended to protect all people. In fact, it left out groups of people, such as women were still considered second-class citizens and denied the right to vote. They were essentially the property of their husbands. Native Americans were left entirely out of the constitutional system, defined as alien people in their own native land. And of course, for the first 78 years after it was ratified, the Constitution protected slavery and legalized racial subordination. Now, even after the arrival of the 20th century, racial segregation remained legal, and it pervaded all aspects of the American society. Gender discrimination was firmly institutionalized, and workers were often arrested for labor union activities. Legal immigrants were often deported because of their political views. And members of minority religions were often victims of persecution. Now, since that time, much has been accomplished in awarding liberties to those people on the margins. But ironically, it is this pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness that is causing great division in our country today. As we see in the Me Too movement, the Dreamers, the LGBTQ community, and the Black Lives Matter. And so it is in this context of striving for justice and respecting the dignity of every human being that we are assigned today's passage from the book of Deuteronomy. So let's take a closer look. In this reading, Moses lays out an ethical system which includes caring for those on the margins of society. As the Hebrew people are about to settle in the land beyond the Jordan, he tells them, "The Lord your God executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing. You shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt." Now, the Hebrew word gar has been translated as stranger, but it also could have been translated as alien or sojourner. This classification of stranger included groups of people as the widow and the orphan, the homeless, those without land, the destitute, the needy, and those who are from other countries. Bottom line is, God loves the stranger. And if we claim to love God and obey God, then we too are called to love the stranger and the alien who live among us. Remember, almost all of us here today are descendants from strangers to this land. The Hebrew ethic of love for the stranger is reflected on a plaque inside the Statue of Liberty. The Statue of Liberty, as you might remember, was given to the United States in 1884 by the French as a sign of their mutual desire for liberty. And on the plaque is written, "Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door." And while our country has never fully realized this ideal, let us not grow weary in treating the stranger among us with compassion and justice. Now, while liberty was the focus of our nation's struggle for independence, freedom is the focus of a life in Christ. Jesus said, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." And then Paul tells the Galatians, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." Now, this kind of freedom is an internal construct where we become free to be able to take ownership of what goes on in our mind and in our heart. Viktor Frankl, who survived the Holocaust, wrote about this inner sense of freedom in his book, Man's Search for Meaning. You see, he tells a story about being in four different concentration camps, and yet he found personal meaning and the experience which allowed him to survive and live through terrible horrors. He said, "Everything can be taken from a man, but one thing, the last of human freedoms, and that is to choose one's attitude in any set of circumstances. While freedom to act in a certain way may be taken away from you, your attitude about your circumstances cannot. And it is this sense of inner freedom that we need to look at as we read the very challenging gospel that is taken from the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said to the crowd, 'You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven.'" Pretty tough, huh? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus sets forth God's vision for a new world where genuine and unconditional love becomes the operating principle. It is a blueprint for a new kind of way of walking in the world where anger and hatred and retaliation and war no longer have a place, where destructive human relationships come to an end. It is a call to stop the vicious cycle of violence and enemy making, and an end where we no longer fight fire with fire, but we quench fire with water. This is a vision of inner freedom, where we are able to rise above our human tendency to retaliate, to rise above our negative emotions, to rise above our bodily cravings, to rise above our addictions, to rise above our sinful impulses, to rise above our painful memories and the traumas of the past, so that we might become the children of God to which we have been called. This requires difficult spiritual work. Yet it is work that we need to embrace if we are ever to be set free. And while we cannot accomplish this task of transformation of the mind and the heart on our own accord by ego strength alone, we need to figure out ways to open ourselves up to God's grace, because it is grace that will ultimately set us free from the bondage of harming other creatures. It's not reason, not laws, and not human effort, but grace. It is grace that will lead us on. Now, while most Americans think that freedom is being able to determine one's direction and shape of their life, Christian freedom is allowing the Spirit of Christ to determine the direction and spirit and shape of our life. Imagine, just imagine for a moment, being free from the constant pursuit of worldly goods and comforts, and instead being satisfied with our basic needs. Imagine being free from prejudice, uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and contempt for those who differ from us. Imagine being free from anger at our own frustration, as well as towards those who do not meet our expectations. Imagine being free from the pursuit of bigger, better, faster, and more, and use our precious energies to care for Mother Earth. Imagine living in harmony with all of God's creatures, appreciating their beauty and their uniqueness, rather than fighting for our own territories. This is the kind of freedom that is promised to those who abide in Christ. It is the kind of freedom that sustains our joy and allows us to pursue the true path of happiness. Christian freedom is achieved by a self-sacrificial love, where me, myself, and I give way to love of God and love of neighbor. Have you ever wondered what happened to the 56 men who signed the Declaration of Independence? 5 were captured by the British as traitors and tortured until they died. 12 had their homes ransacked and burned. 2 lost their sons in the war, while 9 fought and died from wounds or hardship due to the war. Personal sacrifice was part and parcel of the struggle for the liberty of this nation. And personal sacrifice is part and parcel for Christian freedom. And so we continue to seek grace as we pray. Lord God Almighty, you have made all the peoples of the earth for your glory, to serve you in freedom and in peace. Give to the people of our country a zeal for justice and the strength of forbearance, that we may use our liberty in accordance with your gracious will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Please stand as you are able. In the tradition of our church, let us say together the affirmation of Christian faith through the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we pray for the church and our world, if you are joining us on Facebook, please put your own thanksgivings and intercessions in the comments section. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our Bishop, Lucinda, and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our President, for our leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city of Arroyo Grande, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for Father Rob's rest and renewal on his sabbatical. Within our own community, we continue to pray for Sigrid and Long family, Gary and Leslie, Chris Finch, Dale Denauer, Cody Arnold, Denny and Francie, Becky Timinador, Jeremy, X, Joel Jansen, Marsha Boyanitz, Phyllis, Liz Francini, Nelson, Judy Anderson, Peter Z, Rick, Alicia Norwick, Philip Sisko, Steve, and Kent. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, especially Irma Phillips, Vito, Sue, Natoma Canfield, Richard Stolle, Dan Patterson, Neil Philip Lance, and for all the departed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the communion of Barnabas and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To thee, O Lord,
our God. From our bidding book, safe travels for Kadam, peace for Senta, for healing of our nation, Edmund Monroe, Susan, Lynn, Bill Brown, Dorsey Dutton, Alicia Norwicki, Kent, Alex J.
And from Facebook Live, bid your prayers of peace for Bert, prayers of healing for Mark, prayers of peace for Maury Knowlton and family, prayers for repose of soul for Coast Guard Commander Merle Smith Jr. and all who died in service to our country, prayers for safe travel for all this weekend and throughout the summer, prayers of thanksgiving for recovery from surgery for Peter Z. Prayers for the repose of soul for Vito and Sue. Prayers of healing for Nikki. And prayers for the systemically marginalized.
Lord our God, you have made all the peoples of the earth for your glory, to serve you in freedom and in peace. Give to the people of our country a zeal for justice and the strength and forbearance that we may use our liberty in accordance with your gracious will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. My brothers and sisters in Christ, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
God's peace. Please be seated for a moment.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is David Otteson. I'm the vestry member on call today. I have 3.5 announcements for you. First, we're going to begin distributing the communion bread during the Eucharist at the altar rail next week. We're making progress in the installation of our new camera system for our online services, and by hook or crook, we plan to have the chancel area cleared by next week, so people can come forward without worrying about tripping over electronic gizmos or cables. Now, the procedure for receiving communion will be a little bit different than what we're traditionally used to, and Pastor Karen and Deacon Susan will be filling us in on the details of how it's all going to work. Second, we've gotten the go-ahead from the diocese to resume coffee hours after both 8 and 10 a.m. services. Because the parish hall is still pretty crowded, we're going to be holding them outdoors in the courtyard. Now, this is an advantage because mask wearing and social distancing, though still recommended, are optional for outdoor gatherings. This has got a lot of details involved in it, and we're working out the procedure, and we're now planning on holding the first coffee hour in 2 weeks from today on July the 18th. Third, we still need volunteers to teach at our 10 a.m. Sunday services. Right now, we only have enough teachers signed up to teach every other week. This is a vital ministry for our children, for our young families, and for the future growth of our church. So it's extremely important to return to an every week schedule as soon as we can. I encourage you to consider volunteering to teach once a month or more. If you're interested in doing so, please contact Tracy Scoville, who is our Sunday School Director, or Carol Bartolini in the office. And finally, this is more of an update than an announcement. I wanted to let you know that the thrift shop transition team is in the process of leasing a building for the temporary home of our St. Barnabas thrift shop. The property is in an excellent location on Grande Avenue in Grover Beach. Now, the city of Grover Beach has some extremely strict rules about business openings, which makes it difficult to establish a new thrift shop in that city. However, the city planning department has stated that it will be feasible in this particular location. So we are cautiously optimistic that the process will work. So I ask you to keep the transition team in your prayers as they proceed with the application process. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Exciting movements, huh? So we'll talk more about it next week, but with the communion, it'll just be bread at this point, and see how that goes. So I see we have birthdays listed here, and I'll read them out. Chip Dean, Diane David Puhek, and Scott Fisher. Are there other birthdays and anniversaries? Wonderful, Jeremy. Okay.
Our anniversary was yesterday.
Congratulations. Anybody else here? All right. How about, we got one here.
Our son, Chad, and daughter, Sophia.
Are there birthdays?
One yesterday and me, yes.
Great. How exciting. Jeff from Facebook Live, do we have any folks?
Yes. Steve wishes a happy birthday to his nephew Samuel. And Carol wishes a happy birthday to Jeremy.
Great. Well, let's say the prayers together. We'll start off with the birthday prayer. Gracious God, who made us in your own image, we thank you for life, love, and joy. Send your blessing upon these, your children, who have completed another year. Surround them with your grace, fill them with your love, and strengthen them to be your servants in the world. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the anniversary. We thank you, gracious God, for the love you have implanted in the hearts of your servants and for your continued blessing upon them. Give them kind and loving hearts, always ready to ask forgiveness as well as to forgive. Support them through times of trial, strengthen their love for one another, and may that love empower them to be instruments of God's love in the world. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice to God.
How clean are your
Please rise. This Holy Eucharist is offered to the glory of God with special intentions for liberty for all people and freedom in Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. And through your Spirit, you have replenished us and called us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with all the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we fail to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet, you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way for salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Now for the epiclesis, take out your bread. Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into that everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with Barnabas and all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever.
Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters in Christ, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, anything worthy of praise, then think about these things. And may the God of peace bless, guide, and sustain you now and forever.
Amen.
Of the responsibilities that come with the freedom and liberty we have in the United States of America, let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.